$1,000 Buffalo Open. Brought to you by Natural Light Beer. Taste is why you'll switch to Natural Light. Everyone, I'm Jim Roberts. Johnny Petraglia is back with us again this week. And Johnny, as we started, everybody was talking about the young field, the 24 finalists that made it. We are down to five now, but we've got some veterans and some excellent bowlers.
Well, that's true. It was a very young field this week, Jim, that made the finals. But the lanes got pretty tough on Friday, and four of the five finalists are over 30, and the one that's under 30 is a veteran. So I think the knowledge really paid off on the last day of the tournament.
Well, everybody here has won a tournament, so they all know what that's about. And the fellow that's number one is a guy that won it last week, and he's hot, Guppy Troup.
Yes, he is. It's almost like a deja vu. Last year, Wayne Webb won these two tournaments back-to-back. Now Guppy Troup, he won the Super Touch last week in Waukegan, and he's leading again this week in Buffalo. He's really got a hot hand.
Well, we had 192 bowlers. There were 18 games of qualifying. Then, of course, 24 of match play got us down to the stepladder finals, the top five, number five against number four, and so on. A veteran in the number five spot, the fellow that's been on ESPN a couple of times, he's Tommy Hudson. But Johnny, the last time he was in the number one spot, this time it's number five.
Yes, it is. Well, Tommy has really been having a good summer. He had trouble earlier in the year, and now he's got his game back together. His wife had a baby. I know he was thinking about that a long time. Now the baby's healthy, his wife's fine, and he has a clear head, and he's really throwing the ball well. I was watching him in practice, and he really looks ready today.
Well, a 213 average. The scores for the finalists, again, go from 213 up to around 219 or 220. In the number four position, one of the great bowlers again, Mark Roth.
Right, Mark. Well, last week we watched the bowler of the decade, Earl Anthony. This time we're going to watch the bowler of the year for the last 3 years, Mark Roth. And Mark has done it all. He's led in average. He's led in money. And anytime Mark is on, no matter what position he's in, that's the man to beat.
Well, the story on him, of course, he has won no championships in 1980, but he has 5 seconds, and he's just been a tremendous bowler. If he gets number one or number two today, he will be the leading money winner of the tournament for the year, although he won't have won a title unless he gets it today.
That's true. If Mark wins today, he goes into the lead for money winnings, and it's getting late in the season, and it's very important for Mark to win today because a bowler of the year is still up for grabs, and this would really give him a good chance at it.
Well, Joe Berardi is number three. He's a guy that kind of grew up in the bowling world. He's only 25 or 26, but yet you got to call him a veteran, too.
Yes, you do. In fact, Joey was sort of like a little brother in the beginning of his career because he was 9 or 10 years younger than we were, and he's really developed into a great bowler over the last few years. He's changed his game quite a bit, and he won the U.S. Open a couple of years ago, which gave him all the confidence that he needed, and he's been bowling well ever since. In fact, I'm not even sure if he's missed the finals yet this summer.
Well, last year at this very tournament, he bowled a 300 game. It was not in the championship game, and it was not on TV either, so he'd like to duplicate that feat if he can. Another great bowler in the number two position from Charlotte, North Carolina, George Pappas.
George is one of the veterans of the tour, one of the classic stylists of the game. George's biggest asset, he throws a fairly straight ball, not too much hook, and he's extremely accurate. His whole game depends on accuracy. George is the type of bowler, when he's on, he hits his target. And when he hits his target, he hits the pocket. When he misses it, he doesn't. So George's whole game is accuracy, and that's been his whole career. He's one of the most accurate bowlers out here.
Well, he has a 215 average. He is tied with Guppy Troup for the leading match play record of the week, both 17-7. As we told you, the guy that's red hot is Guppy Troup, although last week he was not number one going into the finals, but he wound up winning the championship. Now he comes in, and he is number one.
Well, I talked to Guppy before. It's funny, last night he said it's the most nervous he's ever been. He couldn't figure out why. And I guess overnight he figured it out, because I was talking to him a little while ago and Guppy said, I'm as loose as I could ever be. I'm really ready. He says, for the first time, I honestly can say that I really think I'm going to win this week.
Well, he's got the same shirt, the same pants, or at least he said he was going to wear those same clothes. Superstition, of course, he won it last week in Waukegan. Number five is Tommy Hudson. He'll do battle in the opening match against Mark Roth. The winner of that one against Joey Berardi at number three. George Pappas stands by to take on the winner of that one. And then Guppy Troup will face the winner and the survivor. First prize this week is $10,000 in the $85,000 Buffalo Open. And we'll be back with the opening match on Total Sports ESPN after this message.
Light beer, Mr. Bonaconte.
And I switched to Natural Light.
You switched from that other light beer?
Yeah, I think Natural Light's got the taste that leaves them all in the backfield.
You bet, and there's nothing artificial in this less filling beer. It's made with only natural ingredients.
The real point is taste.
Besides, since I switched to Natural Light, I'm making a name for myself.
Hey, Nick Bonacani!
Where? I know him!
Natural Light. Taste is why you'll switch.
Okay, there's the handshake, and we are ready to go now in the opening match of our ESPN Finals. Tommy Hudson and Mark Roth. And Johnny, when we were down there doing the open just a minute ago, it is very, very warm.
Yes, it is, Jim, and I think that's going to play a very important factor today, especially if the man from fourth to fifth goes all the way.
Tommy Hudson opens the match. He comes from the number five spot. He's got the 10 pin to drop in its tracks, and he opens with a strike.
Tommy looked really sharp in practice, Jim, and he picked it up right here where the match started off. You know the ball is rolling well when it hits that half pocket spot and kicks out the 10 like that.
Here's Mark Roth. He is wasting no time. He'll crank it out there pretty good. Brings it back. Got the action. He drops the pin as well. And both of them have started this match with a strike. And Mark Roth, I had a chance to talk to him, asked him the key to making the final five, and how does he assess the field?
And they went home, and I didn't bowl for 2 weeks. In the last 2.5 weeks, I bowled pretty well. I changed my hand position with the ball. I raised it up higher. I felt more comfortable and more relaxed, and that's probably one of the reasons why I bowled good this week. And the field today, I think it's real strong. Yeah, everybody that's been on the show has been a champion, and we're all proven champions, so anything could happen this afternoon.
Well, he's kind of set the stage for it. He comes back and picks up a strike. He's got two in a row after Hudson started with a strike. We'll remind you, PBA is giving $5,000 for a 300 game on TV during the summer tour. Haven't had any as yet. We've had a couple that have gone 5-6 and one. Steve Cook had 8. Here's Tommy Hudson. And he's got a strike as well. Good action by both of them. 4 balls and 4 strikes, Johnny.
What a powerful shot that was, Jim. Usually it's called swishing the five. When you hit that half pocket hit, you take the five into the left-hand wall. Tommy's ball was so strong that time, it actually pushed the five straight back into the pit before it ever got to the wall. The ball can't hit any harder than that.
These two guys met earlier in the week. Tommy Hudson lost to Mark Roth, 235 to 188. Composite average, by the way, on these two lanes, 219. All the top five bowlers. Tommy Hudson going for a turkey, and he's got it.
Great shot by Tommy Hudson. He really looks sharp on this pair, Jim. He's got his ball rolling end over end, and it seems to be really setting up nice in the end. He's not getting overhook in the back end, so the ball's carrying very well.
What a match we've started with here. Mark Roth now looking for his third strike in a row. Puts it out, puts it in, going to have to get the action, does not, and he leaves the bucket.
A little quick that time for Mark. What he mentioned earlier about holding the ball higher, Mark's fault, if it ever has a fault, is he gets the ball in his swing a little bit too early. And by overcorrecting that, a lot of times it'll make you rush the line just a hair. That's where the extra speed came from, not making the ball finish and leaving the bucket.
Mark, 29 years of age, from Little Silver, New Jersey. 5th appearance on ESPN this summer, including the Masters. Going after the bucket, puts it right down there, just barely kicked that right pin out, and he's got a spare in the third frame.
And Mark looks a little confused about that spare, because when he let it go, it looked like he had it covered perfectly all the way. And the ball actually hooked about 3 boards the last 2 feet. He didn't want to see that happen.
Mark qualified 2nd this week. He was 4th after the first match play block, up to 3rd after the 2nd match play block, and then dropped down to 4th. Looked like he was a little unsure as he let the ball go, and he leaves the 10 pin.
Right, he got up on his toe that time at the line, Jim. That causes your body weight to go forward, and your extension isn't as high as it should be. Almost all the time that that happens, your ball won't have the authority to strike.
He's the last player to win back-to-back tournaments last fall on ESPN, Indianapolis and Cleveland. And he would like to pick up the first tournament of this year. Amazing. Well, guy's won over $80,000 but hasn't won a crown. He picks up the spare, so he has 2 strikes and 2 spares. When we come back, Tommy Hudson will be up in the 4th. He's working on strike, 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 and we'll be back after this message.
So, Timmy, what do you want to be when you grow up?
An Ace Hardware man, Miss Summers, because they help people.
Yeah, like the ones I tell people about on TV?
Uh-huh. Ace Hardware men help people take care of their homes. They show them how to fix things and make things. They know just about everything.
Well, I certainly made an impression on you.
Something like that.
Time to go, son.
Okay, Dad.
Something like that.
Ace is the place with the helpful hardware man.
Well, we remind you, ESPN covering all of these summer events. Total Sports ESPN, our next event is Friday, August the 29th, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific time. That'll be the Canadian Open from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. So join us for that one as well as all of them right here on ESPN.
Really looking forward to that one, Jim. I've never been there before. I hear it's a beautiful house, and it's nice to make trips to Canada once in a while.
Okay, I haven't been in there either, so we'll find out together what it's like. Here's Tommy Hudson. He's got three strikes in a row. From Akron, Ohio, the home of the PBA, the main office there. He's in there, and the seven pin goes, and Tommy has four in a row. Hudson was 32nd last week in Waukegan. There's Barbara Hudson and their lovely daughter. Lisa Ann is what, about 4 months old now?
She's about 4 or 5 months old now, Jim, and as soon as the baby was born, Tommy started bowling better. It shows how much mentally the game of bowling can come into play. As soon as everything was okay, he was okay.
Tommy won here in 1975 when he averaged 235 in the final four matches. He also came from down in the pack, and the 10 pin is up.
Solid 10 pin. Great shot, and the fans appreciated it. The ball did set up just a little bit early, so when it entered the pocket, it deflected just a hair to the right, causing the ring in 10, but things like that you don't correct.
Ace, 32 years of age, 9 years as a PBA member. Coincidentally, he also has 9 tournament championships. And goes after the 10, spares it off. So he has a most respectable 109 through four frames with a spare in the fifth. Mark Roth up now in the fifth frame.
And incidentally, Jim, when Tommy shot at that 10 pin, he used only 2 fingers. And Mark's taking a re-rack right now. He didn't like the way it looked. It's his second of the game, so he has to get permission from tournament director Harry Golden. But Tommy used those 2 fingers to straighten the ball out to make sure it didn't overhook going cross-lane at the 10 pin.
Mark did not bowl on the tour the last couple of weeks, but he bowled a New Jersey regional last week and won a championship, and he gets the strike in the fifth frame.
Trip to four. It's called tripping to four, Jim, and he made a slight overcorrection off the bucket, but he still had the good lift, and he still had the good action to make the head pin and the two pin come off the wall to carry the four pin.
So it's a 24-pin deficit already for Mark Roth. But remember, Mark is working on a strike, and Tommy just to spare, so he'll pick up 10 if he strikes here in the sixth frame. And he does! Perfect pocket hit from Mark Roth in frame number 6.
Well, Mark hit his good lane, and he sure chose the right lane to finish on because he's been solid every time on that lane.
There's Charlie Tapp, who's the alternate of the tournament. Charlie from St. Paul, Minnesota, just missed by 1 pin. And there's a 9 count for Tommy Hudson.
Left the 2 pin, Jim. He got a little quick. The ball hung a little bit on him, and he's very happy to get 9 on that hit. That can be a disaster. Tommy had to throw with a first strike in the 10th frame and then get 9 pins and make the spare to make the show by a pin. And he threw 2 beautiful shots in the 10th frame last night.
Okay, Tommy Hudson going after the spare now in the 6th frame. And he puts it right down there to pick it up. Goes over on the 7th frame now. And Tommy Hudson, I ask him, a special approach coming from that number 5 position. What does he think about?
Well, I think today I'm a little looser. Naturally, when you lead all week, you feel you should win. Today, I'm number 5. I won the last game to get in that position, so I feel like I'm pretty loose today, and I think it's the guy who can win that first match. If I can get by that first match, I think maybe I can zoom up. We'll just have to wait and see.
Dave, and how do you assess it? Tommy Hudson now, 7th frame. Like to get a strike after 2 spares, and he converts, picks up the 10 pin, and he's got it down. Mark Roth is up next in the 7th frame, and we'll be back after this message.
Hi,
I'm Whitey Ford of the New York Yankees. Every 60 seconds, another American is found to have diabetes. If you're overweight, over 35, or have a family history of diabetes, have your doctor test you for diabetes at your next medical checkup. Early diagnosis and prompt medical treatment are the keys to good health. To learn the warning signs of diabetes, call or write your local American Diabetes Association. Thank you.
And now there are only two. Place kicker Raphael Septien defeated Buddy Hardiman, and Dave Brown won over Randy Dean. So the stage is set for the NFL Racquetball Final. It will be Septien versus Brown Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific Time, as this year's edition of ESPN's exciting NFL Racquetball comes to a thrilling conclusion. Be courtside with your Total Sports Network Thursday.
And ESPN presents Auto Racing Sunday at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. This week it's midget racing from Indianapolis. Sunday, August 24th, 9 o'clock, USAC Auto Racing from the Indianapolis Speedrome on Total Sports ESPN. You get ESPN Long Island, John, do you not?
Yes, we do, and it's been terrific. We get to watch everything. As soon as I get home, go to my sponsor's house and watch it.
There's Mark Roth up in the seventh, goes Brooklyn, but he just knocked those pins on the backside, and he has three strikes in a row, five out of seven, and we have a very close match now.
A big, big break for Mark Roth. He even smiled about it. He really didn't throw that ball well at all. He pulled the ball, Jim, across his body, causing it to cross over, or a Brooklyn strike, as we call it. But more importantly, he got past his bad lane. Now if he can hit his good lane, he can take the lead. That could be the turning point in this match.
Mark started off with a 13-57 six-game series in round one, 13-13 in the second round, 13-38 in the third, so he was off to a good start of the tournament. He's continued through, and he mows it down in the eighth frame.
Now, Tommy will have to strike here to take the lead back, also for protection. He doesn't want to Mark to have a chance to lock him out, and more importantly than anything else, he has to stay calm and not let that Brooklyn strike by Mark aggravate him in any way.
Tommy Hudson qualified seventh, up to sixth after the first and second match play blocks, and he strikes in the eighth frame through eight now. Tommy Hudson has 145 on two strikes, and Mark Roth 145, Tommy Hudson 148. Both of them working on two. Mark Roth is actually working on a four-bagger.
And right there, Tommy Hudson showed the champion that he is under the gun, and he made his best shot at a match to take the lead back. It's the best ball he's thrown the whole game, and he threw it in the most important part of the match.
Tommy won $38,000 last year. He's already over $43,000 in his career, $337,748. 213 average for the week.
Solid 10 again, Jim. There's nothing you can do about it. And that solid 10 was different than the last one. That ball really finished hard. That one surprised me. We're going to see it right here. The last one that he threw set up early, causing a solid 10. But this one, he got to his target, and the ball finished very strong. And I really was surprised that this was a solid 10, because he couldn't have thrown it much better. I would have seen it the last 15 feet, the ball finishing toward the pocket. Great shot.
And Tommy has just returned from picking up the spare. The ball almost rolled off the right side on him, but he was able to pick it up. He has a 197 spare. Mark Roth now up on the right lane, four strikes in a row, six out of eight. Mark's had 5 seconds, one third, one fourth, and one fifth this week, and he goes out the window and misses the head pin.
Again on his tough lane. He went Brooklyn last time, Jim. He tried to overcorrect. Extra speed, extra power. You're going to watch it, and he throws it actually too hard. He actually heaves it down the lane. The ball skids another 5 feet, never gets a chance to come back, and he leaves the 1-2-4-8. Mark's got his work come out for him now. He has to make this spare double in the 10th to put a certain amount of pressure on Tommy.
10 years as a pro, at only 29 years of age for Mark Roth, and he puts it right down there. So Mark Roth has a 191 spare, Tommy Hudson a 197 spare, and Mark will be the first bowler to finish as he comes up in the 10th frame. Mark started holding the ball a little tighter at the start. Does he feel a little bit more comfortable? That's the start of the week. finished third in the Fresno Open, fourth in the City of Roses Open on ESPN this summer. And of course, he holds some all-time PBA records. Needs a strike, not going to get there. Does not get that head pin again.
He missed his good lane, Jim, and he really opened the door for Tommy there. The wood was actually important, too. Tommy had to do in the 10th frame whatever Mark did. If Mark makes this spare and gets decent count, Tommy would need a spare. But if he misses this, Tommy just has to keep it on the lane.
Mark's hand scores of 279, 277, 267, 257, 255. The most he can get here is a 228. If he's got to start it off by picking up this spare, and he does.
Great shot.
So he puts a little pressure situation out there. Now, of course, he has a 208 looking for a 228. Tommy Hudson still sitting at a 197 spare. So it's a 9-pin advantage for Hudson. Now, this will be the last ball for Mark Roth.
Here's the situation, Jim. If Mark Roth gets 9 or better on this shot, excuse me, 8 or better on this shot, Tommy Hudson will need a mark to win this game.
Okay, there's a situation. It's on the nose. He has the 8 count and finishes with 226, which is certainly respectable.
Tommy checking the score sheet.
Mark's average had been 216 for the week. Now, Tommy wants to know exactly what he has to get here. So he has a 197, so he has 207.
If he gets 9 and misses the spare, he would lose the game by 1 pin. Any kind of mark, and he's a winner.
Okay. He's not going to get the head pin either. And he leaves 3.
The 245, very choppable spare, Jim. Tommy tried to play it safe, tried to get the ball a little wide, not going through the nose. We're going to see it here, and it's called fanning the ball. When he comes out of it, he gets a little bit lazy and to the right. That causes the ball to skid too far and hang out, and consequently left the 245 spare.
Okay.
Tough shot.
He has to get the spare, and then 3 pins, and he's the winner. So he needs 3 pins and 3 pins, if you look at it that way. And he does not get it. A very choppable spare was the words of Johnny Petraglia, and Tommy Hudson does not get it. Can you believe that? The face of Mark Roth, who has been given second life, and he goes up against Joe Berardi. The final score is Mark Roth, 226, and Tommy Hudson, 223. An unbelievable finish, and we'll be back with the second match on ESPN after this message.
This bird's for everyone who puts it down in black and white. Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser. This Bud's for you.
Well, Johnny, in the sport of bowling, you see everything, but under these kind of circumstances, I know Tommy Hudson's got to feel bad about that one.
Oh, he does. That was an amazing match. Tommy did bowl an excellent game, and but you never know.
Well, it's 226, 223. Here's Mark Roth opening in the second game now with a strike. Mark has not been that successful on the tour this summer as far as winning championships for the year, for that matter. But you give a veteran like that a break like that, and he's going to take advantage of it, you know that.
Oh, if Mark was ever going to feel loose, now's the time. And he threw that first frame very loose. He's really relaxed. He feels like he's got a second life here.
Okay. Pearl River, New York native, Joey Berardi. And he's right there. So both bowlers open with strikes in this match. In the opening match, Tommy Hudson opened with 4. Mark Roth came with 2. And then later on, Mark had 4. Tommy's missing the 10th frame on the 245 is what cost him.
I think Joey's going to be tough today, Jim. He looked very sharp in practice. And going by his first frame, he's carrying it right into the match.
Well, Joey lost to Mark Roth earlier, 267 to 238, so they had quite a match. Joey goes for a re-rack on the lane 47.
Berardi's averaging 226 on the TV pair, and Mark Roth 207. There's Joey for the pocket and the 10 pin.
And Joey's plagued by the same problem that Tommy was on the left-hand lane. Perfect shot, solid in the pocket, and solid 10. So far, that's been the big difference so far today, Jim.
Joey, at age 25, is the youngest of the five finalists. His week's average, 216. His 1980 average, 214. And as we said in the open, he is a bowler from a very, very young age. In fact, he was so small when he started, he had to use both hands to put the ball down in the lane. That is when he started bowling as a youngster, not on the PBA Tour, of course.
Well, Jim, he was pretty close when he first came out. He got into the habit so much that when he first came out on tour, even though he was naturally a good size by then, he would hold it with two hands to the very last second.
He is 5'9", 132. Here's Mark Roth cranking it from the right side. He goes Brooklyn, and he, too, leaves the 10 pin.
And Mark is still lost on the right-hand lane. And going by Joey's first two shots, if Mark doesn't find out how to hit lane 48 pretty soon, I think he'll be in trouble.
Well, Mark Roth, as we said, the last player to win back-to-back tournaments last fall on ESPN, Indianapolis and Cleveland. The fellow that he beat for the title in Indianapolis was Joe Berardi. Fifth appearance on ESPN this summer for Mark Roth. And he has a spare as he converts the 10 pin. The match is dead even after two.
An interesting thing here, Jim, is Joe Berardi and Mark Roth have very similar styles as far as bowling. Joey is a little bit smoother. Mark is a little more of a cranker, throws a bigger hook. I think Mark is going to keep a good eye on Joey. And if Joey is hitting lane 48 good, Mark might try to speed up or crank it just a little bit less to get on the same line, and that might be the way that he'll hit that lane.
Sets the hook, and he's on the nose on this one, and he has a couple of pins wiggling, but they're not going to go down.
Right, that's the 6-7 split, and lane 47 seems to be breaking down a little bit. This will be an exciting shot, Jim, because Mark Roth tries to make everything on the lane. In fact, even in practice, he made the 7-10 split. He'll give this one a try. He throws him hard and cross lane.
He picked up the 6-8, too, the 4-6 any the other day.
Right.
Ooh, he gave it quite a shot, but it just went off to the backside of it and didn't pick it up. Zion effort for Mark Roth, and he's open in the third frame. So Joe Berardi, who won a regional at 17 years of age, comes up, grew 4 inches since starting on the tour, and he's gained a few pounds as well. Had a 300 game in the stepladder finals right here last year. He is short, but he picks it up. A little bit weak, but it got back. Joe Berardi with strike spare, strike down 40 in the second, working on a strike in the third frame. And Joey had a big year last year, hasn't bowled that much this year, so how is his overall game?
Well, now I've practiced this week prior to the start of this tournament, and I feel that my game is at a point that it was at last year. So I'm pretty confident in my bowling for the next 2 weeks, for the end of the summer tour and the fall.
He won over 67,000 last year. Sits at 18,000 so far this year. And the final kick, and Joey has two strikes in a row now, 3 out of 4. Mark Roth is open in the third, so Berardi has opened up a 23-pin advantage, and we'll be back to Buffalo after this message.
The Winnipeg Blue Bombers record-breaking passer Dieter Brock will be back in the pocket Saturday on ESPN as the Blue Bombers take on Hamilton in more exciting professional football from Canada. Brock, who's averaging over 20 completions per game, will have to stay out of the clutches of a blitzing Ticat defense led by linebackers Ben Zambiazzi and Louis Clair. Professional football from Canada, Winnipeg versus Hamilton, Saturday at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 Pacific time, exclusively on ESPN.
And a reminder of the All-Star Contest featuring the best players from the Baker League in Philadelphia and New York City's Rucker Tournament, some of ESPN's fine coverage throughout the summer. Monday, August 25th, 9:30 p.m. Eastern, 6:30 p.m. Pacific time for that one. That's two of the three leagues in ESPN's summer basketball action to wrap up their 1980 play. Total Sports, ESPN. Here's Mark Roth trying to bounce back after that split and open in the third frame. Brings it weak, and he has a bucket.
again with the bucket, and that time Mark did move out a little bit. He lived a little bit to his right. He did sit behind Joey and watch him throw his frame, and he moved to the same place where Joey played, but threw just a little bit too hard. I think he's in the right area, though. On the next time on that lane, if he slows his speed down just a little bit, I think he'll be lined up on 48, and we could have a heck of a match.
Mark holds the all-time PBA record for most money won in a single year, $134,000. Not bad. Goes after the bucket and does not get it, and that is the same situation, except for the extra pin that caused Tommy Hudson to miss in the 10th frame.
And that time, as soon as he let it go, Jim, you remember he almost missed it the last time, but as soon as he let it go, that hit the same identical board halfway down the lane that Tommy Hudson did. And it's amazing that it ended up in the same place. Shows how tough that spare is today.
Ross, match play record for the week, 13-11-0. Had a 226 average after the first round of play, dropped down and has 216 at this moment. 226 in the opening game, and he leaves a 10 pair.
Good shot from Mark on his left-hand lane. That's his good lane. Solid 10 again. Solid 10 is plaguing all of the bowlers on the left-hand lane. When they threw the ball very well and did hit solid, that pin doesn't want to go down.
Now, for four straight years, this man has claimed the George Young Memorial High Average Award in the PBA Tour. But still, it's just amazing that we are in late August and Mark Roth has not won a tournament this year.
I'm sure, even for Mark Roth, that as you go all year and you get close five times, as he has, if the pressure does start to get to you, you want to win before the year is open. Mark is setting a record for winning the most money and never won a title in one year, but I'm sure he doesn't want to hold it. He'd rather win three or four times.
That's true. But he'd like to win some cash as well. He told me he'd like to retire as early as possible. And Joey's got two pins up.
Now, Joey got just a little bit of an open hand as he let that ball go. He didn't turn the ball or lift the ball as hard as he usually does. He did hit his target and his speed was good, but lane 48 is without a doubt the tougher of the two lanes. The bowler that conquers this lane will be the winner of the tournament.
He leaves the 5-8, which is a bit unusual. And he picks up the spare, so Joe Berardi has 88 spare through five. There's his lovely wife, Debbie. Mark Roth is 56 spare. So it is very fine, the 32-pin advantage midway in the game for Joe Berardi.
Debbie's quite a girl. I was in their bridal party when they got married, and she had five sisters. They all looked the same.
Joey was third here in 1977 and last year, 1979. He had been hot last year until he was seated second. Eventual winner Mark Webb beat him in the semifinals after he rolled that 300. He had the high six-game block for the week this week, 14-25, and he did it with shots like that.
Now watch, great form of Joey Berardi, how he's progressed over the years. Good straight foot, perpendicular to the line, great high follow-through. Keeps the ball right on line, thumb up in the air. And the end result.
You are looking at what Mark Roth has left up there.
Mark Roth's smiling now, Jim. He's honestly so lost on lane 48 that everything he tries doesn't work, and he's reached the point where I think he's saying there's nothing I can do, so let me just throw it and hope.
Well, Tommy Hudson, I think, is probably looking at this one as Mark Roth's ball even goes farther to the left than Tommy. And Mark Roth has three opens in the last four frames, and through six, he has an 81 open.
Jim, this is the one thing about our sport that is different from all other sports. There's an old saying in bowling, a condition can make you look terrific or make you look horrible, no matter how well you perform.
Well, it bombs away as Mark Roth's approach has been referred to as like a cavalry charge, and he mowed him down in the seventh frame, and we'll be back with Joe Berardi after this.
Next 60 seconds are for men and women who want to succeed in business. For 60 seconds, I'm going to talk about something that can help you. This, the Wall Street Journal. The Journal is the only national daily business publication. Every business day, the Journal's staff of business news experts reports anything happening anywhere that can affect business, your business, the latest management trends and techniques, news of government, labor, your competition, up-to-the-minute business information, often available nowhere else.
Information that can help you do your job better, make smarter business decisions. Rusty, you every business day to use that day. There's nothing else like the Wall Street Journal.
Call toll-free 800-228-3300 and get the Journal delivered to your home or office for 26 weeks for just $33. 26 weeks, 130 issues for $33. That's 800-228-3300. If you want to succeed in business, call now. Don't let another 60 seconds go by.
Well, if you've enjoyed NFL racquetball this summer, you will enjoy the finals on Thursday, August 28th at 8 p.m. Eastern. Rafael Septien and Dave Brown will meet in the final match, the racquetball finals on Total Sports ESPN.
There's a great game. If you want to keep in shape, Jim, that's the one to play. Because my roommate, Dave Davis, he plays with his wife, and Joey Berardi asked for a re-rec and did not get it. And looking at the rec close up from where we are, there really isn't anything wrong with it, except maybe the three-pin might be sitting back a little, and from Joey's angle, it might look a little worse than it really is.
Looks good from here. Joey dropped from second down to third in the position round. He has never been lower than five for the week, so he has really bowled well. Leaves the four-pin there, but he's got a very comfortable lead. With the spare here, I have 128 to Mark Ross, 81.
Now, Joey made a good shot there, and he's not making the mistake of laying back. He knows that if he marks out, he's going to force Mark Roth to strike out to get the game close. But he's still charging the pocket. He's not trying to hit light and play it safe.
He has no opens. He has three strikes. He looks now for his... He has four strikes. He looks and picks up his third spare. So Joe Berardi has 128 spare and Mark Roth 81 strike. There's the other finishers.
Charlie Tapp, who missed by one pin. And from 13th down, we have Wayne Webb, who's in currently for Bowler of the Year. Mike Albee, third on the money list. Tita Semez out of New Jersey. Willie Willis, who's having a very good year. Jeff Valentine bowling terrific this summer. Jim Shelley and Tommy Baker, Buffalo's own Tommy Baker, who's had an excellent summer.
Of course, some of those people that have been on ESPN for the summer, Tommy Baker's been on a number of times. Tommy, I guess, would like to get on again. He's had a couple of miserable games his last couple of times on. Joey in the eighth has a strike. Tommy, of course, mentioned from Buffalo. So Berardi has 148 strike. Mark Roth up now in the eighth frame. And he has but 81, but he's working on a strike, and he's not there again.
Now Mark again trying to overpower this lane, and this is a very tough thing to do, although Mark's done it in the past. Watch him, he turns it extra hard because the lane doesn't want to finish, yet all it does is still skid out, and by the time it makes the move, it's too late, leaves the washout.
So he goes after this, picks it up in fine style, so he's got a spare now in the eighth frame, but he is still pretty far behind. As a matter of fact, it's a 47-pin advantage. And not only that, but a strike for Berardi up, and Roth only a spare, and there's just two frames to go.
That's true. If Mark wants to be the Sunkist Open champion, he's going to need a miracle these last two frames.
He has a good strike. He's had some beautiful shots on that left lane. He's had some not so good, but he just, as you mentioned, hadn't been able to do anything with lane 48 on the right side at all.
That's what we talked about before, Jim. Now, if for everybody at home that's watching, it's obvious that Mark isn't bowling well only half the time. So lane 48 is playing very tough today.
George Pappas, another one of the greats, is next. And then the red-hot Guppy Troop in the number one position. There's a strike for Berardi, so he is working on a double now as he will start into the 10th frame. In case you missed the opening match, Mark Roth defeated Tommy Hudson 226 to 223 when Tommy Hudson did not convert a 245 in the 10th frame. He needed just to pick up that spare and get three pins to win it, and he chopped off the five. First ball, 10th frame, Joe Berardi is on the nose.
Joey got a little soft after he threw the strike in the 9th frame. A little bit of an adrenaline drain. He knew the game was out of the wood. He got a little soft in the 10th frame.
That is a good time for a leave if you're going to leave one with a good advantage.
For sure.
And he will go after the two pins there. Picks him up. And he finishes with a 2-0-3. The most Mark Roth can get, even with four strikes, 181. Oh, there's the 4-6. Also on that lane on the right side. $10,000 goes to the winner. $6,000 to second on 5-4, 3,500. Similar breakdown to last week's Waukegan Open. Only thing is, it was $11,000 to the top prize winner. And Mark Roth picks up one pin out of that and finishes with a 149. The final score, Joe Berardi 203. Mark Roth 149. George Pappas is next, and we'll be back after this message.
This book tells you how to cut your costs for food, medicine, insurance, and gasoline. This book can tell you how the events taking place in the world will affect you and your way of life. This book tells you how to get money from the government for housing, education, medical care, or travel expenses. This book can help you know just a little more about everything than the other guy. This book tells you what foods to eat to stay healthy and what drugs to avoid if you're sick. And this book can give you confidence, self-assurance, and a wealth of knowledge. This is the special Newsweek edition of Health, the indispensable guide for consumer information. And this is Newsweek. Help retails for $6.95, but it's yours free when you buy 24 issues of Newsweek for $15, only half the newsstand price. So call now, 1-800-528-6050. Get 24 weeks of Newsweek at half the newsstand price. And upon payment, your free copy of the special Newsweek edition of Help. 1-800-528-6050. It's toll-free and major credit cards are accepted.
And George Pappas shakes hands with Joe Berardi. Well, we've had a couple of kind of unusual matches, John. 226-223, Tommy Hudson in the opening one, chopped that 245, and then Mark Roth bowling a 149 in the second game.
It's amazing. I think it makes the people at home feel good sometimes, Jim. When the bowler of the year bowls a 149, when they go out in bowl league, they don't feel so bad. It just shows it can happen to anybody.
So Joe Berardi will start it off. He lost to George Pappas earlier in the week, 223-186. Joey, as we said, averaging 226 on the TV pair, opens the match with a strike, just like he did in the opening frame of the previous game. And George Pappas from Charlotte, North Carolina. He has the classic style, an arm swing, arm close to a slender body. And a lot of people, if they want to learn how to release the ball and how to approach, ought to watch George Pappas. On the nose, going to get two of them out of that and just leave the seven pin.
Well, George got a little bit slow on that first shot on lane 48. Now, watching him in practice, he did hit light a couple of times on that lane, so just a little bit of an over-adjustment.
George averaging 224 on the TV pair, and he had a 181 and a 265 to achieve that. He qualified fifth, was 11 after the first match play block. Second after the second match play block, went to third and then came up back up to second in the position round, spare in the opening frame for George Pappas from Charlotte, North Carolina. And I asked George how important is weight control and positional conditioning.
Well, weight control is not real important if the bowler's in good shape. There are certain things that you can do that will enable you to get around any kind of problems, whether you're overweight or whether you're underweight. Physical conditioning, that's a different story. Some players work out and run, do a lot of stretching exercises. I limit my physical activities or physical workouts to trampoline a little bit. I have a trampoline at home and I work out on the trampoline, and that's about the extent of the physical work that I do.
Karate the best, John?
I think so, although I do have a trampoline too, and I do a lot of trampoline workout. George, incidentally, on that shot left a solid four, and George had so much confidence in himself the first four or five frames, he'll just analyze the pair to make sure he's lined up right and then try to really cut it loose.
George was second in Portland on ESPN and, of course, in the Masters as well. Going after the four after he negotiated the seven in the opening frame. He has two spares in a row, and now we go back to Joe Berardi. Joey did a lot of practicing, as he told you, prior to this tournament. And he feels it's made quite a difference. He started off this tournament in 11th place, jumped in the lead after two rounds, and held down the top spot after the third and the final round of qualifying as well. The youngest of the five finalists at 25, but not the youngest of the 24 by far. On the nose.
And Jim, lane 48 is getting tougher. Joey went a little wide in his last match on that pair a couple of times. Tried to stuff it up there, and the ball just jumped through the nose. I think, as I said earlier, the bowler that conquers 48 will win this tournament.
Berardi has 32 200 games this week. Got 10 in a row at one point. His match play record, 15-9, and he just drills it over there, picks up the spare. He has a 20 spare through two, and George Pappas with a 19 spare. So Berardi leads by one. And Joe, in the final five games, five of the last six games, prior to the finals, rolled a 223, 220, 217, 258, and a 220, and then in the position round, a 184. But he picked up the number two spot, and his round six total for eight games, 17-24 series. He actually had a 230 average after the second round earlier in the week. Joe Berardi puts it up short, and he has a similar situation we've seen about four or five times already.
And Jim, that time, Joey hung up in the ball a little bit, causing him to leave the 2-4-5. Now, I noticed that Joey, as you'll see here, when he's coming out of the ball, he hangs up in a little bit. His hand rolls around to the right, which causes the ball to skid too far to the right. And he aired his hand a long time, and it's getting hot up here, so it must be really hot down there, causing the bowler's hands to sweat. Sometimes they'll dry it off and use too much rosin and hang. If they don't get it enough, it'll slip. So there could be a problem developing with the heat.
Well, he broke that 2-4-5 right apart, drilled the ball right down through it. He has two spares in a row after opening with a strike. And here's George looking for his first strike. George Pappas for the pocket and a hole, and George has a strike in the third frame.
Oh, what a tremendous shot this was, Jim. You notice the perfectly straight arm swing of George Pappas, perfectly straight follow through. And George is further out to the right than anybody else trying to conquer this lane. Look at how hard that ball hit, throwing the five into the left-hand wall.
Okay, here's George Pappas now up trying for his second strike in a row. He took second by bowling a 220, five strikes in a row at the position rounds, frames 4-8. Looking for his second strike in a row. He's on the nose, and he gets the four.
High pocket, solid four. George is about two or three boards further left on lane 47 than he is on 48, and he's really closing in quick now.
That is a second straight four-pin lead on that lane. Left a seven in the opening frame on the other lane, and then came back to strike in the third there. Led Mark Roth by 52 pins going into the position round for third. Came away with second place. Roth remained at four, won the opening match, lost the second in the finals. And the spare for George Pappas. So Pappas has three spares in four frames. Berardi, two spares in three. The match is close. It's only a two-pin advantage for George Pappas. We'll be back with the last of the fourth after this message.
Men's World Fast Pitch Softball Championship will be decided on ESPN Tuesday, September 2nd at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 Pacific Time. Prior to the finals, enjoy a total of eight quarter and semifinal round games as your Total Sports Network brings you softball at its best here on ESPN.
AAU Boxing on ESPN, the National Junior Olympic Finals, Saturday, 4:30 p.m. Eastern Time on your Total Sports Network.
Well, just a couple of more weeks, and we will have wrapped up our summertime coverage on ESPN. The next event, Friday, August 29th at 8 o'clock, PBA Bowling, the Canadian Open from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Following that one, we'll have the tournament from Sarasota, Florida, which will air on September the 5th at 8 o'clock. And don't forget, we'll have more in the fall on Total Sports ESPN.
You know, Jim, we're catching a lucky break there because the Canadian Exposition is there, and we're going to get there just before it ends, so we're going to get a chance to go and see it.
Joe taking a lot of time now. trailing by just two pins. We're in the fourth frame. Remember, he got a 300 game last year, and he's bowled well here, and that's going to get an extra one out. Dropped right back down through it, and he has an eight-pin count. And at through four now, only two strikes have been thrown, one from each bowler.
Now, although it's only a four-pin difference in the match, Jim, Joey's going to have to recompose himself here. He's hitting the pocket well in the first match, and now he seems to be getting in a little bit of trouble, and George is hitting the pocket. Joey's going to have to get on track, put a little bit of pressure on George.
Joe Berardi has 55 working on a spare through four, and George Pappas, 59 spare, also through four. Just a four-pin advantage for George. Joe, who won, as we told you, 67,000, almost 68,000 last year, only 18,000 this year, career earnings 202. His hobbies, he is tennis, and he's also a skeet and trap shooter. Does not practice a whole lot on tour, but off tour, he really bears down, as he said he did last week. And George Pappas did as well. He picks up a strike. Joey in the fifth frame.
Great shot by Joey, a very important shot too. He has to show George that he can establish himself again on at least his good lane, and he made a perfect shot here. Good lift, nice straight follow through, and when the ball hits as hard as this, watch the six pin come off the wall and kick out the 10. That's when you're throwing the ball well.
George Pappas, who has a college degree in business administration. 13th on the money list, and we have somebody talking loud in the background that is disturbing George, and he will put ball down and start all over, and that is the thing to do when something is bothering you.
Exactly. Tip to all the younger players that are ready to come out. If something distracts you, step back and start over again.
Absolutely. George is one of the coolest customers on the tour. Look at the concentration now. He just has completely mentally regrouped. Throws it out, gets it in, and gets the strike.
And makes his best shot of the match.
That's right. He just turned an adverse circumstance completely around to work in his favor and still retains that four-pin advantage. George, is he still the chairman of the PBA tournament committee, is he not?
Yes, he is, and he's done a great job. He's been chairman for 4 years. He's usually the chairman, usually only serves a two-year term, but George has done such an excellent job that he was reelected, and his fourth year is coming to a close pretty soon, and everybody's grateful to him. He's done good work.
And he's got to hear all the gripes that people have.
Oh, yes, and we have a lot of them.
George comes back now, sixth frame, other side, and again, four pin, third time in a row that pin has plagued him on that lane.
Now, he left another solid four on that lane, Jim, but that time he jumped on the ball. He didn't really make a very pure shot that time. The reason for the four pin wasn't because he was lined up wrong. It was because he didn't throw the ball as well as he could.
George Pappas, averaging 224 on the TV pair. That's slightly under the average of 219 for the five finalists. Going after the spare now for the third time in a row, he picks it up. So nobody is open in this game as yet. George has a 99 spare. Berardi 75 strike as he's ready to come up in the sixth frame. I'm Jim Roberts with Johnny Petraglia, 14-time PBA champion, also the PBA president, and your term is about ready to end.
Yes, it is. It ends December 31st, and I'll still be on the executive board. It's a question of whether I'll take a year off or not from the gripes, so to speak.
Okay, Joe comes back in the pocket and picks up the strike. Berardi with a double. That's the first of the match for either bowler.
And Joey really got excited about that one. He used extra speed, extra power to keep the ball on line, and he really wanted that one because now he goes on his good lane. If he can hit this lane, he can get more than a 10-pin lead. A little bit of a cushion.
He won the U.S. Open last year and pocketed $21,000, also the Tucson Open. And as we told you, he started at a very, very young age. From Pearl River, New York. Seventh frame. Out and in. Oh, look at that! The old
heave-ho on the 10-pin. It is down. Joe Berardi with a three-bagger. And we'll be back to Cheektowaga, New York, after this message.
Has been presenting auto racing, sprint, midget class competition, stock, and IndyCar racing as well. We invite you to join us at 9 p.m. Eastern Time on Sunday, August 24th, for the USAC auto racing from the Indianapolis Speedrome. It's midget racing this week, and it's on ESPN.
This is our commissioner, Jim, Joe Antonora, and he's been with us a long time now, and he's really done an excellent job. PBA's come a long way in the last few years.
He is from Akron, Ohio. Yes. Here's George. George's a little bit high. He does not get the seven. The pin rolled through, and he's got an eight count.
George, a little bit soft after coming back for that 30-second or 1-minute spell on the bench there. And that does happen to a lot of bowlers. They get a little bit soft when they lay back that extra minute.
He leaves the 4-7, so he has, in his five non-strikes, he has had either the 4 or the 7, or both, and no other pins left. He picks up the spare, so George Pappas has 117 working on a spare through seven, and Joe Berardi is 105 in the fifth on a double. Pappas left the 7 pin in the first frame, the 4 pin in the second frame, the 4 pin in the fourth, the 4 in the sixth, and the 4-7 in the seventh. So he has left nothing else but a 4 or a 7 or both.
Close but no cigar.
Close but no 4-7. Here's George Pappas now. 211 average this year, 215 this week. Ooh, outside.
George lost that ball off his hand. He's, I think he's gonna get some rosin. If we'll watch here, you'll watch the ball comes down almost right on the foul line, comes off his hand really quick and skates right. And he misses the headpin, leaves the 1-2-4. Crucial spare here for George. He's really put himself in a predicament with only a couple of frames left for him to bowl.
George won this tournament back in 1970. He was third in 75. And perfect picking up that spare. Two ways to get it. He got the best way as he drilled it through the two pins, and he is a spare in the eighth now, working on a 134 in the seventh. Berardi is up in the eighth, and he's on a three-bagger.
Right about now, Jim, the thing that goes through a bowler's mind, Joey Berardi is in the two teens, somewhere between, we'll say, 210 and 214. He knows that if Pappas strikes out, he can only bowl 214. So he knows if he gets one more strike and two marks, he controls his own destiny.
He, too, not going to get there and leaves just one.
A little wide on that lane. He's very happy to get a nine count. Right there, the wood was extremely important, Jim. Should he make the spur, he'll have a 20-pin lead. Anything less than that would have put it under 20, and it does make a difference. When you're in bowling, you count by those 10s. Under or over is very important.
And he goes after the 2-pin, picks it up. So he has a 20-pin lead as of this moment with two frames to go. 154 spare, 134 spare. He's just bowled super all week long. As we told you, he was a qualifying leader, second after the first match play block, down to fifth after the second match play block, and then wound up in third position after holding second for quite a while last night. He had the high six-game block for the week at 14-25. Berardi is right in the pocket on that one.
It's good lane, Jim, and that was very important. George knows what he has to do now. He must strike out, or at least get the first two, to put some type of pressure on Joey.
George qualified second here at the Thruway Lanes back in 1975, lost to eventual champion Tommy Hudson in the semifinal match, 244-232. Looking for his first win since the 1979 Tournament of Champions. His work
cutout point. George Pappas needs it, has to have it, gets it in the ninth frame.
Great shot by George when he needed it. And Jim, George is wiping his forehead. When he was up on the line that last shot, he was sweating so bad that the sweat was going into his eyes. And George, well, George doesn't sweat in the steam room. So it's really getting hot down there.
Charge in round five in the tournament, 1783. Eight-game series, started off with a 13-53, and his match play record, a very splendid 17-7. Got to have this strike. 10th frame, trailing by 20. He has it, just perfect. George Pappas with two strikes in a row to try to apply as much pressure as possible.
No four-pin here, Jim. He couldn't have thrown this shot any better. That's why he's the champion. He is class shot, high follow through. Look at that end over end, the last 10 feet.
Perfect.
Ball finishes right into the 8-9. Perfect shot.
He had 33 200 games this week, including nine in a row. Gained about 5 pounds. Went up from 130 to 135.
Well, Jim, if George strikes out, he would have a 214. If Joey Berardi's hair strikes, he would have 214, and we could have a possibility of a tie.
It's on the nose. Will it go? It will not go. Four pin. His nemesis.
Again with the solid four. If we were to have a tie, they would bowl a ninth and tenth frame sudden death throw off. Here's that shot again. He's left three or four pins here, Jim. Another good shot, but another solid four in it.
He has left four pins, a 4-7, and a 1-2-4 in this match. And he picks it up. He finishes with a 203, the exact same score that Joe Berardi won with in the previous match.
Jim, this is interesting. Joe Berardi's in the same position as Tommy Hudson in the first match. If he misses in the 10th, 9 out, he loses by one pin. Any kind of mark, he's a winner. We'll see what happens to Joey this time.
Okay, now mark, and that's it. He has marked all the way through. 10th frame, Joe Berardi puts it out there, safe, gets to 7 pin, and he's won the match.
Great shot by Joey. He really trusted that one right up the boards at the pocket. Figured the worst he could do is get 9, and he could make that one pin spare. That's the way you win titles.
So the man from Pearl River, New York, will do battle with the man from Jacksonville, Florida. Guppy Troup in the championship. He leaves the four pin. But he has this match wrapped up. He has a 203 in the ninth, and a spare will give him a 223. And Guppy Troup, the man who was in the number two position last week, won the championship in Waukegan. Established himself at the number one position here, and he rolls 223. Joe Berardi gets a 223, the same score that Tommy Hudson lost with in the opening match, and Pappas gets a 203, the same score that Berardi won with in the previous match. We'll be back after this for more from the Buffalo Open.
We looked at Celica, Accord, and Scirocco, but when we looked at this new Mazda 626, that's all it took.
Just one look. That's all it took. Yeah, just one look. That's all it took.
We really like the way this Mazda 626 performs, not to mention its great mileage, all at a price that makes it really worth looking at.
Yeah, the more you look, the more you like.
Well, we are ready to go in the championship game now. There's a stepladder so far, and you see some similar scores. We have two 223s and two 203s all the way up to the championship now. Guppy Troup and Joe Berardi. They have met twice previously. There's the handshake, and Guppy Troup has won both matches, defeating Berardi 217 to 200, and then at the position round 196 to 184. Guppy Troup is averaging 219 on the TV pair, Berardi 226. The alien, John Guppy Troup from Jacksonville, Florida, and Joe Berardi getting ready to go first.
This should be an interesting match, Jim. Guppy in the same outfit he won with last week. He's superstitious about wearing what he wins in. We'll find out what happens today.
No, I've seen him a couple times during the week. He's had it on. He just doesn't take it off. Berardi opens with a strike. Three consecutive matches to Joe Berardi has opened with a strike. However, previous two matches, he has come back with a spare in the second frame. Guppy Troop from Jacksonville, Florida, the master of the gutter shot, but he said he hasn't been shooting that shot this week.
No, he hasn't. He's been between the first and second arrow or around the second arrow most of the week. We'll see where he is right now.
Guppy brings it in light and leaves just one pin.
Well, he's right outside the second arrow, Jim. Since he hit light, he's probably playing the second arrow.
He qualified third. He was first after the first match play block and then remained first after the second, and he is still first. Led by 150 pins just going into the position round, so he has had it easily. And Guppy Troop goes after it, picks up a spare in the first frame, and I ask Guppy Troop, the natural progress from last week, or does he have to make adjustments?
Well, I've changed. The only thing I've changed is I'm not shooting the outside line this week. I'm shooting a second arrow, and I'm using a different weight bowling ball. Other than that, I just feel as loose as I've ever been.
It's an interesting comment, Jim. Last week, he admittedly was extremely nervous, and he bowled a great game on TV and won the tournament. And this week, he admittedly is loose, and we'll see how he performs when he's loose as compared to when he's nervous.
Well, he was number two last week, we told you, and then won it. Prior to that, there had been 5 weeks in a row that the number one man had won. Earl Anthony, top seed last week, did not win it. Troop is top seeded here. Second frame, 10-pin for Guppy Troop.
Solid 10 on that 47 again. That's a terrific lane to the pocket, Jim, but knocking down the 10-pin is a trick.
He bowled a 223 and a 245 in his two games last week. Started the first game with four strikes and started the second game last week with five strikes. And this time, he starts with one spare.
It's Tom Nevitt, Guppy's roommate, and he's got his fish. Tom's crazy.
So Guppy with two spares. And Berardi comes up now on the right side. After opening the match with a strike, we'll remind you again, PBA is giving $5,000 for a 300 game on the TV tour this summer. And Berardi is the last guy to have a shot at it on the show.
You know, Tommy Nevitt's about 5'5" and 115 pounds, and his nickname is Big Boy.
$10,000 first prize in this tournament. $6,000 to the second place. Berardi, right straight in there, leaves two.
Bad shot. He pulled that one, Jim, right through the nose, leaving the 3-6. And he's very happy with just leaving this. You'll notice that his swing comes inside into his body and then out, and that causes the ball to go through the nose and leave the 3-6.
15-9 is his match play record. Started off at 5-3, 9-7, and then increased it in the final round to 15-9. Berardi got the back pin, but just had to slide that 3-pin out of there. And he has a 20 spare. Guppy Troop with a 19 spare.
And Joey likes to shoot those choppable spares by throwing the ball as hard as he can to eliminate the hook and cut down the possibilities of a chop. But sometimes it can throw off your accuracy.
That gentleman there is Harry Golden, the PBA tournament director, who is looking the situation over. Joey has asked for another re-rack. It's the second on that particular lane. And he's going to give it to him. Concentration on Harry's face.
It's a tough job for Harry. He has to make sure they're all on spot. It can really psychologically throw you off. If you think a pin is off, it's tough to throw the ball correctly.
And you got to have good eyesight.
That's true.
Because he stares it down from quite a ways away. Third frame now. Joe Berardi. He's there. That's right there. And Berardi's got a strike in the third.
Well, so far, Jim, the matches have held true. The person that conquered lane 48 was the winner in each of the three games, and so far, neither one of them have hit the lane yet so far this game, and we're going to see if that's going to be the deciding factor.
Guppy Troop had a 222 average last week. this week, 219. 17-7 match play record, same as George Pappas, and he is there himself in the third frame. Both bowlers with strikes in the third.
Guppy really is throwing the ball well the last 2 weeks. That lane has been reacting a little funny for most of the bowlers, but sometimes, similar to last week, Guppy's getting a different type of ball reaction. He's getting a real true ball reaction to the pocket. That's when you know you're at your peak.
Guppy at 5'8 or 5'7 and a half is the shortest of the five finalists. We told you at the top of the show that they call him the alien because his family originally from Scotland.
He's got his guppy around his neck too there, Jim.
Something's fishy here.
Oh.
Troop is gonna barely slide it and he's got a sleeper.
Guppy missed the better of the two lanes, the lane that he chose to finish on. That's very important. And he has a tough spare, double wood. The ball has to come in from a strong angle and either hit the two pin on the nose or a little bit on the right side. Anywhere on the left side and you'll leave the back pin.
He has the 2-8. He left the 2-pin in the opening frame and the 10 in the second. He got his strike in the third. Berardi with a strike in the first and the third. And Guppy, who trailed by one, needs this spare, and it's a tough one. Yep, good shot. So Guppy True pass, spare, strike spare. They're not falling like they were early in the matches. And Joe Berardi is up next in the fourth when we return to the $85,000 Buffalo Open, and we'll be back after this message.
Now there are only two. Place kicker Raphael Septien defeated Buddy Hardiman, and Dave Brown won over Randy Dean. So the stage is set for the NFL Racquetball Final. It will be Septien versus Brown Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific Time, as this year's edition of ESPN's exciting NFL Racquetball comes to a thrilling conclusion. Be courtside with your Total Sports Network Thursday.
Okay, here's Joe up in the fourth. They just fumbled on the left side, and Joe Berardi's got two.
Oh, you were right, Jim. That's the perfect words for it. He crumbled him.
So Berardi has a 40 on two strikes through four. Guppy Troop 59 in the third, and despair in the fourth frame.
Joey knows his key. He knows how important this lane is to hit. That's why he got so excited. Look, extra lift, extra speed. Keeps the ball on line. Now watch how hard this ball hits the pins. The ball takes the five out, and the five pin took out the 4-7. That's power.
Gives him an 11-pin lead as he's up in the fifth frame. Won a regional at 17 years of age. He's a veteran at 26. Got it. Duplicate.
You got it. Perfect duplicate. Two great shots. Notice that the ball went in at two different angles because 47 swings back more than 48, but the hitting power was identical when it got there.
Three in a row, four out of five. Joe Berardi, who got a 223 in his opening match, defeating George Pappas by 20. Here's Guppy Troup. Had the high three-game series for the week, 770. High 24-game final, 52-42. Ouch.
The big five, Jim. That's what it's called. It's the 4-6-7-9-10. Now, this ball is actually about an inch away from being a strike, Jim. But it hits high on the head pin, and from that outside angle, just cuts right through the heart of the pins. Watch a ball go straight back. And it just, we call it disintegrating the rack. That's what it's, that's the nickname for it on tour. Now, he's going to have to give this a try, because the wood really isn't that important. When you get a five-pin count, you've lost the wood already.
Yeah, he was on a spare, so that wood is going to hurt him, and he gets just one pin and gives him an even 80 now through five frames. He came in with two spares, strike spare, but then a five and a one. He only went from a 59 in the third to an 80 in the fifth, and he was already on a spare, and that is not a good count.
No, it isn't. He's down an even 40 pins now, Jim, and we're already halfway through the game, and he's going to have to start striking, otherwise Joey's going to get so loose there'll be no way to catch him.
Last week he had an eight-game series of 1947. The best he did this week was 1864, but he kind of went down through the week. His final eight games, only 16-21. That's a long way from 1947. He's on the nose again, no split this time.
Guppy, in the beginning of this match, was making good shots, but the last couple, he's gotten a little soft, causing his ball to hook early. That means causing it to hook in the front half of the lane instead of the back half of the lane where it should be hooking. And, well, naturally, he would have to correct it to have any type of chance to win this match, but it's getting awfully late. He must realize it as soon as possible.
He, of course, had the record last year, bowled the most 300 games in one season. He got six of them. And he picks up spare rather easily in the sixth frame. Joe Berardi, four out of five strikes in that big 5-1 of the fifth, has certainly hurt Guppy Troup, and here's Berardi up in frame six.
Here's the key, Jim. Here's where you really want it. You got a guy by 40 pins, similar to a boxer. You need that killer instinct. You have to try to get him while the man is down. You don't want him to come back up at you and give him any breathing room.
There.
Jim, that one hit the same place as the previous two, but it actually hit harder. It hit even harder than the last two. This five pin gets to the left so fast that only on replay we could see it. How hard it got there, and Joey ended up on lane 46.
He is on a roll. Four strikes in a row. Five out of six up in the seventh. Born November 20th, 1954.
Guppy's concentrating, maybe depressed. He doesn't want to look.
Fine round of applause from the crowd here at the bowling center in Cheektowaga. After four strikes in a row, he leaves the 4-7.
Little light, little extra speed. That's an adrenaline pump. That wasn't a chicken out kind of shot, Jim. He did hit his target, but he's so pumped up now, he threw it a little too hard.
He just barreled that ball right down there that time. Berardi working on an excellent game, and he has not had an open frame since he started way back against George Pappas. We'll be back after this message.
United States Air Force, a great way of life. Find out how you can be part of it. For the location of your nearest Air Force recruiter, call toll-free 800-523-5000.
Okay, Guppy Troup, seventh frame, trailing by 48. He knows it, and you know it, what he has to do. Here it is. First shot, good one.
Great shot by Guppy. Getting up on the easier of the two lanes now. He's got to have this one. Here's Guppy's best shot of the match. Nice and firm and up the boards, not trying to belly the ball too far or arc it to the right. Now notice the ball stays on line. Beautiful.
So Guppy Troup has 100 working on a strike through seven, and Joe Berardi 148 spare through seven. So it's a 48-pin difference, but Troop is on a strike. Berardi is spare, so this one is most important for Guppy to cut that lead down to 38. Still lots of time. He started on the previous strike, going after another one. Not quite as good a hit, but he got the strike.
Excellent shot. Although the ball was light, Jim, it was an excellent shot by Guppy because he trusted the ball. Trusting the ball means getting the ball wide with good lift and not pulling it to the nose. And he trusted the ball very well when he needed it. And you'll notice the ball hits just about as hard as Joey's. Five pin taken out the pins.
So he cuts the 10 pins off of that lead. Berardi working on a spare, like to get a strike up in the eighth. Got a 223 in the opening match and has a 148 spare through six here.
Shot for Berardi. A little high. Spins around to the four, doesn't get out.
Joey flew his elbow that time and he knew it. He's really happy with nine on that hit. He came back shaking his head. What I mean by flying his elbow is that when he let the ball go, his elbow kicked to the right. Now, as your arm goes to the right, naturally your hand comes in towards your body, causing the ball to go high.
And he goes after the four pin and just drills it down. He's got a spare. Our thanks to Joe Antonora, the commissioner of the PBA, and all the PBA staff. Larry Weindruth, director of operations for the PBA. Harry Golden, PBA tournament director and his staff. Lyle Zykes and Denny Schreiner for media relations. Chuck Pisano, our TV coordinator. Jerry Bach, local tournament director, and Art Kurtz, the manager of Thruway Lanes here. Our statisticians, Mike Durbin and Frank Ellenberg, Jim Rosenberg, producer from ESPN, Kent Samuel, our director, and all of our ESPN crew. Joe Berardi, ninth frame. In there. Good shot for Berardi in the ninth as he bounces back.
Big, big shot for Joey there. He can't lose any wood, so he doesn't have to worry about that. Now, every strike for Guppy is a must strike. The first time he doesn't strike, the sun kiss can't be his.
He is working on two strikes. But Berardi with that strike in the ninth, a big one. He is on the ninth. Oops.
That might have been a little bit of sweat, Jim. He's going back to the rosin bag. As we mentioned earlier, it is warm down there.
Maybe a fly or something, too.
That's true.
Guppy Troup, when he needed it, with only one strike through six, has come up with a turkey.
Great shot again, Jim, by Guppy Troup. He's figured it out. He started making really pure shots. Good high extension, getting the ball through that first 16 feet of the lane. Ball setting up perfectly. We have a match now going into the 10th. This isn't over, not by a long shot.
Guppy won $31,890 last year. He is sitting on $31,820 now, so he will surpass 1979 regardless of what he does. He is a pro bowler, but here he lists bowling as his hobby. Okay. I thought for sure he would list swimming.
Here it is. 10th frame for Guppy Troup. Outside, inside. 10 pin.
Guppy left the 10 pin. Good shot when he needed it.
Fine round of applause by the crowd here.
But he knows, and Joey knows, that Joey now has to stay behind the foul line, Jim.
Yep.
And keep the ball somewhere on the lane surface.
Spare strike for Guppy would give him a 199. Joey has a 197, so he would need just three pins total wood in the 10th frame. And that's even with Troup getting a strike now in his third ball in the 10th frame.
Jim, I think the big turning point in the match was when Guppy got a little bit soft in that fifth frame and left that big five. It wasn't only the open, but it was five and six out. He lost a ton of wood there. And it really got Joey loose to come back and throw that four-bagger to take a commanding lead.
No opens in either game for Joe Berardi.
Here's Troup. Getting a nine-pin count. Just kind of tossed it out there, that's
yeah.
All. So he finishes with a 198. Joe Berardi has a 187 strike, so he is sitting on a 197, as you said he is. Has to keep it behind the foul line. Get a two-pin count and two balls, and he is going to get it, and this match is over as Berardi has a nine count in the 10th frame. Well, he had two previous PBA titles, and he will add a third. The two previous ones being, as we told you, the U.S. Open and the Tucson Open, both last year at 1979. Berardi's got a spare, so he has 207, looking for a strike to give him a 227 final.
And this was a terrific crowd, Jim. You have to admit, they they watch this type of bowling all week, they realize that the scores weren't that high. And when you threw four or five in a row, they know how well you bowl, and they really reacted to it. I want to congratulate the Buffalo fans here.
There's the final ball. Look at that. So he gets six, and we'll be back after this message.
Hello, I'm Jim Simpson. Great names like All-Americans Art Schleister, Mark Herman, and Ron Simmons. Great teams like Alabama, Southern California, Ohio State. How's this for one of our matchups this fall? Tennessee and Southern California at Knoxville, where the Volunteers are mighty tough. Bud Wilkinson will be with me, and every weekend starting September the 6th, no less than five games. NCAA college football, the best, the top teams. You'll see them all here on ESPN.
And there's the champion of the Open, Joe Berardi. And we have the trophy and the check presentations to Joey. We'll have that for you. The gentleman will just pass it along to him. For Johnny Petraglia, I'm Jim Roberts. We've got to go, and we'll see you next time from Buffalo, New York. So long, everyone. Network.